Hello, everyone. Sorry, so we are 2 minutes past and I guess we should get started. So I'm Himani Arora, currently working as software consultant at Knowledge5. In today's webinar, we will be discussing about Kafka streams, how can it be used for performing join operations, how is Kafka streams easy to use, how can it be used as an embedded database, so that we do not need an external database. So let's quickly go through the agenda for today's meeting. So we will be discussing about Apache Kafka, a brief overview of Streams API, how can we use Streams API. Then we will get into the details of the join operations, which are supported by Kafka Streams, and then discuss about various types of joins which are possible in Kafka Streams. Okay, so before we begin, what is Apache Kafka? So Apache Kafka is a distributed streaming platform, as we say and as we have. But what exactly does it mean when I say that it's a distributed streaming platform? So a distributed streaming platform has three capabilities. First, it should be able to publish and subscribe to a stream of records, very much similar to a messaging queue. It should be able to store those stream of records in a fault-tolerant manner, just the way Kafka does. And it should be able to process the stream of records as they occur. So Kafka is run as a cluster on one of your servers. It can process the stream of records. It stores the stream of records as they come, which are produced by the producer in the form of topics. Now this topic can be distributed among various partitions, and these partitions are handled by brokers. Now each topic consists of messages, and a message consists of three parts. It is going to have a key, it is going to have a value, and a timestamp associated with the message when the message was produced into the topic queue. Kafka has four core APIs. The first one is producer API. So producer API, it allows an application to publish a stream of records to one or more Kafka topics. So as we saw in this diagram, a producer API, it will enable our application to publish a stream of records into a Kafka cluster, into one or more topics. A consumer API, which is the second core API of Apache Kafka, it allows an application to subscribe to one or more topics and process the stream of records produced by them. So if you see again in this diagram, we have a consumer. It subscribes to these topics, it keeps polling the messages and processes them. The third one, which we are going to discuss in detail today, is Streams API. Now Streams API allows an application to act as a stream processor. So basically what do I mean is, we can consume an input stream from one or more topics and perform some transformation, perform some processing on that input topic, and generate or produce an output stream. Now this output stream can be produced to one or more topics. So in a way, we are transforming the input stream into an output stream with the help of a Streams API. Connector API, which is the fourth core API provided by Apache Kafka. It allows building and running our producers and consumers that connect our Kafka topics to some existing application or database system. Now, what do I mean is, suppose I have my MySQL server and I want that the messages in my Kafka topic should be migrated into my SQL Server database. Now, what would we do is, we'll use a connector API in between those so that we can capture all these messages into an RDBMS with the help of connector API. So these are the four core APIs which are provided by Apache Kafka. Okay. Now, before we discuss about Streams API, let's quickly understand why stream processing is even required in the first place. Why are we even discussing about it today in this webinar? Okay. So we all know that databases have been an integral part of our industry and they have been widely used for decades. We are conditioned to think that data is going to be stored in databases, in the tables, in the form of rows. And then it is further going to be used in a data warehouse system where we can perform our analytics and our reporting on it. Correct. Now, when we talk about today's scenario, the world has drastically changed. It's no more such simple. We are becoming more and more digital. Now, when I'm saying we are becoming more and more digital, I mean that businesses are becoming more digital. So everything in businesses today is basically a stream of events. Let me give an example. So if I talk about retail sector, we have streams of orders. If we talk about finance, we have streams of stocks. If we talk about websites, we have streams of impressions, streams of clicks. So in this kind of data processing system, we take all these input systems and turn them into output streams. So in this new world, the databases are shared by a slew of distributed databases. The services are no more simple monolith services. They have been broken down into microservices. And also, there's a huge push from batch to real time. So this transition from the old world that we were talking about to this new world needs a fundamental shift in the way we used to process our data, in the way we used to think about processing. We are today more inclined towards processing the data as it occurs in the real time. So what we are talking about is we want to do stream processing on our data, which is as it is streaming and in the real time, I even want to process it and generate my reports and use it wherever I want to use. Now, Kafka Streams API is one such library which has been provided by Apache Kafka. So it was open sourced in Apache Kafka from 0.10 version onwards, and it's a very powerful client library. One of the very important and a key benefit of using this library is that it does not require any additional cluster. So this is a very important part of it, that we can use it wherever we want to. So it's a very simple application which can be created as a standard Java application that we normally code, and it can run on any client machine. So in a way, Streams API, it's highly scalable, it's distributed, it's fault tolerant, and it is secure as well. Since it is built on top of Apache Kafka, it leverages all the capabilities of Apache Kafka. So there are two main abstractions of the Streams API, as we can see in this slide, a K-stream and a K-table. So what are this K-stream and K-table? K-stream is basically a stream of key value pairs. It's stateless. So everything that's come into our topic, it can be transformed into a K-stream, into a stateless K-stream. And a K-table, it's a changelog stream. it holds key and value pairs of our messages. And the key is always going to be unique. So it will always hold the latest message of that key. So K table is very much same, act like our relational table in which key is a primary key. Now, when we say, if you remember, I just quoted that Streams API is capable enough to be used as an embedded database and eradicate or eliminate the use of an external database required for processing our data or to perform joins on a data. Now, how is this possible in Apache Kafka? With the help of interactive queries, we are able to achieve so in Apache Kafka. Now, what basically will happen is we have a Kafka cluster which contains all our messages, all our topics, and our Java application, which is running on a client machine, which contains a Kafka Streams processing application. It is going to consume messages from that topic in real time. It is going to process those topics, and it is going to open a readable query state store on those topics. Now, this queryable readable state store, we are able to perform a GET call on that, or we are able to perform REST calls on our state stores, and our applications can directly fetch data from those state stores. So there is no need of a database here to process our data, to perform joins in our data. So basically all the things can be done in our application itself. It will be stored in our Kafka embedded database in the form of state stores. And these state stores are also queryable and accessible. So this eliminates the need of an interactive of an external database. So interactive queries is another powerful feature of Apache Kafka. And we will discuss about interactive queries in detail in our next few webinars. Okay, so I've been bragging about Kafka Streams, I'm bragging about Streams API, but how do we use it in our application? How are we going to install Streams API into our system so that we can leverage its capabilities? Now, fun fact is that no installation is needed for using Streams API. Basically, the motto of Streams API is that we want to build apps, not clusters. So it is a client library, like I said, and it can be used into an application like any other library. So you can just inject this dependency into your Maven, into your POM, and it's ready to use. So it's very easy and it's very powerful. Now, let's get into details of Streams API. Let's get into details of how can we actually perform joins in Streams API and what all joins are possible. Now, Kafka Streams supports three types of joins. An inner join. Now, inner join gives an output just like a relational join. It gives an output when both the input sources have the same key. So if I have two topics, let it be customer and address. Now, if both customer and address share the same key, only then we'll get the joined output as a result. Left join, it gives an output when for each record in a left or primary input source, if the other table or the right input source or the secondary input source does not contain that key, it is set to null. Very much like a relational joins. Output joins remains the same, just the way we used to do in our relational databases. Outer joins, it gives an output for each record in either of the input sources, be it the primary input source or the secondary input source. Now, if one source contains a key, the other is set to null. So these are the type of joins that are currently supported in Apache Kafka with the help of Kafka Streams. Here, type 1 symbolizes primary type and type 2 symbolizes secondary type of the join. So you guys are aware of what is a K-stream, what is a K-table. Now this global K-table is a little new. We didn't discuss about it. We don't know about this. but in the further slides, we will come across this global key table again, and we shall discuss about it. So it is possible to perform an inner join, a left join, and outer join on a K-stream, K-stream join. Whereas in a K-stream, K-table join, we cannot perform an outer join. And the same is the case with a K-stream and global K-table join. Now let's shortly discuss all these type of joins and what are they. So let's start with a K-stream, K-stream join. Now K-stream, K-stream joins are windowed joins. By window, I mean that the developer has to specify how long should that window size be so that only those records are joined which have the time difference up to the size of the window. Now again, let's come back to a customer and address example. So I have my window size set to 5 milliseconds. Then all those messages that come into my customer topic queue and that come into my address topic queue, they will be joined whose timestamp difference is less than 5 milliseconds. Now, this is required because what happens in the background is every time a K-stream join or any join is to be performed, a state store is created, and that state store stores are messages on which the join gets performed. Now, if there's no window mentioned, since it's a K-stream, the state store will grow indefinitely and it will not be possible to perform an efficient join. So that is why we need a window join. If you look into this example shared over here, we see that the output of a K-stream join is a K-stream itself. This left is a left input stream and we have a right input stream. Now this K-stream join is always a keyed join. So the key of left input stream should match with the key of right input stream and the output should be this. So the values are concatenated over here and given as an output to this output K-stream which is joined. We are specifying the join window to be 5 milliseconds and we are specifying the certs over here. The cert of our key is string. Of our left value which has been used as long and the right value being used as double. So this is how we need to specify a value joiner, how we need to specify a join window whenever we are performing a K-stream join. Now a K-table join is very much different from this. So one of the major difference between a K-table join is that it is a non-window join. A K-table is basically a changelog stream of updates. So every time we have a K-table, it is materialized into a local state store so that a table is maintained which contains the latest value for a key. Now when we get two K-tables which are to be joined together, so if a lookup is done on the matching join records between both the key tables and correspondingly we get a output key table which contains the join result of both the key tables. Now it's a symmetric join. It produces a key table as an output. Again, this is an inner join which has been done. So the key of left and the key of right stream should match and only when we'll get our desired output stream, which is the joined output stream. The third type which are we going to discuss is a K-stream K-table join. Now, it's different from both the joins that we just discussed. Unlike K-stream join and a K-table join, it's an asymmetric join. Now, what do we mean by asymmetric and what do we mean by symmetric? By symmetric, I mean that whenever there is an arrival of a new message into our topic queue, the join gets triggered. So in our K-stream join, if the left or the right stream, either of them gets a new message, the join gets triggered and a join output is produced. But in the case of asymmetric join, the join is triggered only when the left input stream gets a new input record, while the write or the input table that we're using holds the input records and is only used to update a materialized table. So here the primary source is a K stream and the secondary source is a K table. So every time we get a new input record into a K stream, the join will be triggered. And that is why it is an asymmetric join, whereas both the joins that we earlier discussed are symmetric joins. The syntax of a K-stream K-table join is, it produces a K-stream as an output. And again, it's a keyed join and not a non-keyed join. So the join is performed on the key of the left stream and the right table. So we are performing a join over here. We are specifying the value joiner, that is the output, which should be produced by a joined output stream. We are specifying the certs, which are to be used. The next join, which is a K-stream global K-table join that we are going to discuss. Now, before I start with explaining about a K-stream and a global K-table join, let's quickly discuss what is a global K-table and how is it different from a simple K-table. Now, like a K-table, a global K-table is also an abstraction of changelog streams. Here, each data record represents an update, just like we have in our changelog streams. But a global K-table differs from a K-table in a way that it is populated with all the data. So let's take an example that I have an input topic with 5 partitions and I want to read this topic into a table. Also, I have an application which is running on 5 application instances to maximize parallelism, obviously. Now, if I want to read this input topic into a K-table, then a local K-table will be maintained on each instance of an application. And this local K-table will hold data, will be populated with messages from only one partition of this topic, 5 partitions. But instead, if you're using a global K-table on the application instances, each application instance and each global K-table of this application instance will hold data from both, from all the 5 partitions. So this is what the difference is. A K-table holds data of only one partition that is assigned to it, whereas a global key table will hold messages from all the partitions of the topic. So in a way, global key table is very useful when we want to perform large joins so that we have all the data populated into our state stores before we start processing with our joins. So a K-stream global key table join is a non-window join and it is a non-keyed join. So we can define a foreign key join over here. I can define between my, suppose I have an example of customer and address. I can define that customer ID, which is used as a foreign key in my address table, should be used to perform join. Now this is the only join which is a non-key join supported till now by Kafka Streams. So it allows efficient joining. It allows us to perform star joins with large scale fact streams with our dimension tables, where the facts are always going to be in K streams and our dimension tables are going to be in global K tables. Now the output result of a K stream is K stream global K table join is always a K stream. And if you see in this example, we can see that we have left input stream with a right global K table and we're defining a key over here. So our key is left key dot length. So now a join is to be performed between the key of right and of left key dot length. So we are deriving a new key against which the table should be looked up and the join should be performed. So the new key of left and right and then how we perform a join. So we will also demonstrate this example using an example of customer and address shortly, and it will become more clear there. Okay, let's quickly jump on to our example. So I'm going to start with my Kafka streams. I'm just starting with my Confluent server. Okay, so till the time it started, let's quickly have a go through of the code that we are going to use. So here we are going to perform a keystream join and a keystream global ktable join. Now we have a customer and an address stream, like we said. So we are using a keystream of customer and a global ktable of addresses. And we are going to perform a global ktable join. So here the value joiner over here is this. So we are producing a new customer address value, which is a joined output stream of both customer and addresses, such that it contains only those records which has the join, inner join between their cust IDs. I'm specifying the new key to be used to look up against the table to be a customer.address ID. So only those records which have the matching address ID should be used to perform joins and produced as an output stream. Okay, so our Confluent is up. For this, we are going to use a sample data generator. This is a very basic sample data generator. It is going to produce few dummy messages into our address and customer topic to start with our joins. So now you see over here, we have produced some 10 records. If we start with our keystream global key table join, we should be able to see join records of both address streams and okay. So we are able to see the joined output records of address ID, which was the matching address ID between both. So here in our joined output stream, we have the key specified to be an address ID and we get messages from both address and customer. So I'm getting the address ID using from the address table used as a foreign key in customer and the customer details as well. Okay. So these are the references that we referred for this webinar. So that's the standard documentation of Apache Kafka Streams, Confluent documentation of developer guide of starting with Kafka Streams. And this was a very good blog which has been used in Confluent to give an introduction to streams and the joins that are done in Apache Kafka. For question and answer, since it's already past 30 minutes, you can email me all your queries regarding Kafka Streams and the joins. And we will also share the slide deck and the demo webinar video with you on your emails. So this is my email ID and you can send all your doubts over here. All right, thank you.